Hello and a very warm welcome, viewers. You're watching the brand new edition of To The Point with your host, Kriti Mishra. Over 1.5 lakh people have been evacuated from low-lying areas along India's western coast because of cyclone Tauate. NDRF teams are on the ground and in action. And joining me today on the show is Chief of National Disaster Response Force, Mr. S.M. Pradhan. Sir, welcome to Rat Sabha TV and thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Sir, before we talk about your preparedness, help us understand the factors responsible for the genesis of this cyclone.
Well, the first uniqueness about the cyclone must be also outlined. The unique factor for the cyclone is that this is the beginning of the cyclone season, and probably after more than a decade, for the first time, a cyclone system has built up in the month of May, which is a summer month, in the Arabian Sea. Normally, the cyclone systems start in the Bay of Bengal, and like Amphan, like Phoni before that, everything has started in the Bay of Bengal. So this is something new. The second thing is that probably we can see the impacts of climate change now, because the Arabian Sea is much hotter, the surface level is much hotter than before, and when there are temperatures, they add to the gale force and the wind force of the cyclone. So systems have combined together to make this a very conducive situation for the cyclone system to develop. It started somewhere south or east of Lakshadweep, came over Lakshadweep, but has normally generally bypassed the coast. It has stayed on the sea, hundreds of kilometers into the sea, but that itself has had a lot of impact in terms of rain and some wind in the coastal states along Kerala, Karnataka, Lakshadweep, of course, Goa, Maharashtra, and of course now Gujarat. So Gujarat is going to bear the impact, but the system is a unique system that has developed. But I think that the situation was conducive for it to develop as it has happened now.
All right, sir. Indian Met Department has already warned that Cyclone Tauate is expected to intensify into a very severe cyclonic storm. Tell us about NDRF's preparedness.
In fact, let me correct you there. In fact, the latest document that has come out of the IMD says that Cyclone Tauate will be just before landfall, will turn into an extremely severe cyclonic storm, which is in excess of 160, 180 and going up to 220 on the sea. The good thing, if it can be called a good thing, is that when it lands, it will be probably one step down, which is called a very severe cyclonic storm, which is a category one step down from the extremely severe, which brings down maybe another notch, 15 to 20 kilometers less. Still, the landing speed could be up to 180, 185 kilometers gusting, which is very severe by any standards, and which is going to match Amphan, because Amphan was 190 in the region of 190, 200. So this is 185. So if it stays true to form, or if it ups its act and continues as an extremely severe cyclone, that also will be a very dangerous situation. So all in all, NDRF is prepared for the worst case scenario. That is the principle with which it makes the preparations. And the key issue would be evacuation of people so that lives can be saved, precious lives can be saved. You know, there will be damage to trees, there will be damage to kacha roofs, kacha houses, there will be damage to telephone lines. All this, we take it in our stride, and the restoration which will happen to build back faster will be a key factor. But then saving lives, because we cannot afford to lose life, and the Honorable Home Minister, the Honorable Prime Minister also held a meeting day before. Honorable Home Minister, they held it yesterday. The chairperson of the National Crisis Management Committee, the Cabinet Secretary, held a meeting yesterday, and everybody was very clear that we should go for a zero casualty approach. Zero casualty should be our objective. Only when we go for that objective do we optimize it. You know, sometimes you are not able to optimize it. Sometimes you are not able to optimize it because people just take the risk of venturing out or not allowing themselves to be evacuated. So we have discussed this at length with the state government, and the chief secretary and others were impressed upon by the central government, the union home minister, that don't take a chance. Whoever is in the possible harm's way and is in not a proper accommodation in a kacha house, certainly they should all be evacuated to safer places. It's a matter of 2 days. It has to be done. But things should not be given left to chance. So that is the principle with which we are working, hoping for the best, but preparing and expecting the worst and preparing accordingly. And as I said, the bottom line is saving lives.
Saving lives, absolutely, sir. That is of paramount importance. But what kind of evacuation operations did you have till now in what all states, and how has it been so far?
It is good because disaster response is primarily a state subject. The local administration is at the front of it. We have gone as a force of assistance, but we are very proactive in this, and whatever is given at our disposal and whatever is given to us as a task, we are doing it. So, a lot of evacuation work, a lot of awareness generation, a lot of even COVID protocols are being being evacuated to safer places. And more than 1.5 lakh, nearly 2 lakh people have been evacuated in Gujarat alone. Of course, in other states, which is not high impact state, there have been some evacuations in the coastal areas, but they are not to the volume that can match Gujarat, because Gujarat is going to be the main impact state. The good thing is that the state administration and the district administration and all the 10 plus affected districts of Gujarat or potentially affected districts of Gujarat have taken very proactive measures, and evacuation has gone on very smoothly. We hope to complete before probably 1600 hours today, so that by the time around 8 p.m. the cyclone makes landfall, everybody who has to be evacuated is evacuated.
Sir, the IMD has also predicted major damage post the landfall, of course. Tackling any after effect must be a very, very difficult task. What kind of operations take place? Help us understand, sir.
Well, the difficulty is actually multiplied because of the COVID situation. If it were not a non-COVID situation, things would have been much, not easier, but certainly probably predictable to handle, but COVID introduces the X factor into this. But in spite of that, we have made our preparations, and as you said, restoration of and building back better to restore normalcy would be of critical importance. So, as has been the principle with which NDRF works, NDRF stays as long as the state wants it, unless it is more emergent to go somewhere else. So we will be hanging in there. We will support the state administration in the restoration process and do whatever is required to do it. Just to give an example, in the morning today, there was a road blockage by a tree and electric pole in the Goa state. And a lot of oxygen tankers which were going for COVID duty were stuck. NDRF was used, and we immediately cleared the roads on priority because we realized that it is two priorities, not only clearing the road, but clearing the roads so that the oxygen tankers can go to the destination, probably hospitals which are requiring it very, very emergently. So this is the X factor, as I said, the extra factor rather, which has to be kept in mind. So NDRF will be there at the disposal of the state government for as long as it is required.
Sir, as you mentioned that the COVID-19 pandemic has thrown a huge challenge to rescue and relief operations across the globe, how did NDRF develop new standard operating procedures for its personnel and also victims during these trying times?
It was difficult, but I think after almost a year of this experience, please do not forget that by this time last year, the COVID situation has already started, and the challenge was already in front of us. And we faced the cyclones like Amphan and Nisarg in the COVID scenario. And so, while the vaccinations were not available at that time, we followed a lot of strict and disciplined protocols, as a result of which, in spite of exposure, in spite of infections which were there in hundreds in the NDRF itself, we could protect our personnel, and there was almost no casualties. There were one odd casualty that was also because of the comorbidity, but I think unlike the other paramilitary forces, of course we are the smaller force, but then we could save the lives of our personnel because of the discipline and because of the absolute adherence to strict protocols of humanity, of sanitization, of masking, etc., and social distancing. We have taken it a notch higher, because this time the situation is
much more difficult. The infection rates are very high. The variants are very, very different. So the possibility of infection is very probable. That is why only those personnel have been deputed who have already had the double dose of vaccination. Having said that, I must also qualify that there are hardly any personnel left in NDRF as frontline workers who have not had completed the double dose of vaccination. So that gives us a lot of assurance that both of the doses are administered for those who have gone on duty. The second is, you can see, behind me, you can see the visual, they are fully protected. You know, the fully masked, the head-to-toe coverage is there, and they also carry their own medicine. The doctors are accompanying them. So it is a very disciplined way of operating, not only living normal times, but also operating. Even the operation is COVID-contexted, so that they know what to do. And when they operate and when they are exposed to the common citizens, they also, even if required, they also distribute masks first and make them aware of social distancing. Before taking them to the cyclone shelters, for example, they are made aware as to what to do and what protocol to follow. Even in the cyclone shelters, they are told how to keep distancing and how to keep their sanitation protocols absolutely in order, so that it does not become another problem. You are trying to come out from one problem of cyclone and you take on another problem of COVID infection. So, and finally, as far as NDRF is concerned, the principle is very simple as in an airline. The airline safety always tells you that first you protect yourself, first you wear your oxygen mask, and only then you will be able to save the others. So this is what has to be done in a very, very focused and disciplined manner. And I think that I'm proud that my NDRF personnel are doing it and following the guidelines to a T.
But the SOP for the victim, sir, in this kind of a situation, which is a very dangerous situation, and of course there is a lot of restlessness on the part of the victims as well, how difficult is it to ensure that they follow those protocols?
Yeah, I'm glad you raised that question, but the good thing again is that there is a lot of experience in the public also about the COVID protocols now. It is not 2020 beginning, March 2020 or April 2020, where people are still struggling with what to do and what not to do. I think the do's and don'ts are very well known to the public now. It is another matter that because of frustration, because of probably COVID fatigue, they have indulged in some indiscipline. But I think it is known, and because a force like NDRF speaks to them very openly, this there is a lot of acceptability of NDRF in the public, and they listen to NDRF with a lot of seriousness. So that has helped us, and we have not found any difficulty in communicating with the public about protocols and the rules to be observed, COVID appropriate behaviors to be observed. We have got the cooperation, and I think we'll continue getting the cooperation the rest of the season.
All right, sir, since we're talking about rescue and relief operations, there are forces on standby to deal with any situation. Tell us about the deployment plan.
100 plus teams have been committed across 6 states and 1 union territory of Daman and Diu. Obviously, because the Gujarat state is going to bear the maximum impact, in fact, the direct landfall is happening only in Gujarat state. So that is where most of the teams are committed. Almost 50 plus teams, if you include the SDRF, are committed in Gujarat itself. 10 plus districts are going to be affected. So accordingly, depending on the impact factor, teams have been distributed. And they have hit the ground running, so to say, and they have started working for the last 3 days now. This is the fourth day. And as we speak, the last of the contingents have arrived by Air Force flight in Gujarat. So we are good to go in all respects, and I just hope that we are able to meet the situation square and are able to save lives. As I said, as far as public property is concerned, there will always be some scope for damage. But if we can save lives and going by the protocol of zero casualty, if we can ensure that, that will be an achievement.
Sir, I remember last year also while I was interviewing you for Amphan, we had also discussed the training module. Sir, how are the NDRF teams trained to handle such disasters and extreme weather conditions?
Well, I think, I can only say that, experience matters. You know, once you are exposed to such situations, I think you get used to it. And we must remember that they are all derived from the paramilitary forces. Somebody is from CRPF, somebody is from CISF, somebody is from BSF, somebody is from ITBP. So they are, it is not as if they have not seen extreme situations, but probably of a different kind. But they are aware and are used to danger of some kind. This is a different kind of danger and this is a different kind of challenge. But their experience holds them in good stead. And they are good fighters. I find that after 6 months of training in the in-house and NDRF, they become very attuned to handling natural disasters. And the best part, I think, is that they are very, very sensitive about handling citizens, old people, children, women. You know, that sensitivity is of great, importance. And that sensitivity has really added a great dimension of acceptability and a love of, love and respect of citizens across India. And this, I think, is a feedback loop. When they find that there is acceptability, there is, people are blessing them literally, old mothers and old women, bless them, call the NDRF personnel, bless them by touching their head. Children, hug them. All these are such positive feedback that whatever rigor that they have to go through the training, there is a lot of rigor in the training. They are happy to do that. So, to sum it up, the NDRF, if it is not operating, it comes back to the battalion and trains 365 days of the year. So, it is always, in a way, in action mode. And that has, helped us sharpen our mental tools and physical tools, and we are able to handle any situation. Risk exposure to any situation, and as you can see, what can be a greater risk? COVID is there all over the place, and in spite of that, NDRF is with the people, for the people, and helping them throughout. And not for one, the NDRF operative thing, not for once does he think that this is a COVID situation, and COVID has infected that village, which is going to be cyclone affected, I should not go. Never it crosses his mind. On her mind. And that, I think, is the asset, the mental strength of the NDRF personnel, and that has come out of a lot of rigorous training, which is both mental and physical.
Sir, during our previous interactions, you've also stressed the importance of infrastructure, of advanced technology and equipment. Have we upgraded it now?
I think we are well on our way to upgradation. There is a lot of support from the Government of India. And I must share that out of the 16 battalions, which are various stages of formation, we have got land for most of the battalions. Even the four new battalions, we have allocated land. We have got land because of the support of the state government and the central government. And those which are older battalions, the first 12 or the first 10 battalions, they are all well on their way to be fully established in terms of infrastructure. As far as the equipment is concerned, we have upgraded our equipment, that has also helped. And we have upgraded our IT systems, our control room. So all in all, I think the modernization drive has paid off. We are even going to use body cameras very soon, where rescuers going into a rescue situation will actually be able to relay through their body cameras exactly what is happening. And sitting in the control room, the DG, I can actually talk to the victim, visually talk to the victim and assure him or her that we are there, the entire NDRF is there for you. And I can talk to the rescuer also and assure him that you are in a tough situation, but we have your back. So this is the kind of connectivity that we are going to implement very soon. And we are working with the IT Ministry for GIS systems. We are working with CSIR. We are working with DRDO for Make in India products of disaster response. The principal scientific advisor held a special meeting so that we could have Make in India products, Atmanirbhar Bharat products, so that the disaster response products which are normally imported from Germany, Japan, the specialist equipment, all that can be replicated here, replaced here, and we can have our own new ventures coming out
startup ventures which can give us disaster response product. Let me just give you a very good example in the Chamoli disaster. Drones were used by private companies who came to help NDRF, and they are all startups from India, young men and women from India who have set up their startup companies, drone companies. This is going to be more the norm than the exception, and in the future it will be a great ensemble of products which are Indian products, disaster response products, disaster response technologies, which will be leveraged by India and leveraged by NDRF in particular. So it will be a matter of pride for all of us.
So, matter of pride, as you said, another achievement that I'd like to highlight is the induction of women combatants in the NDRF. Are they being deployed now in these cyclones?
There is a standby team which is waiting because the Ghaziabad battalion, where there are a maximum number of women are there, they are all on standby duty because we had the Chamoli disaster and some other forest fires, etc., where they went. So, one of the teams which is on standby is all women team also. So, it may be possible that maybe in the aftermath of the cyclone, they may be thrown in into Gujarat also. So, that possibility is there. But the good thing is that more and more women are starting to come in from other forces. And we have now almost 200 personnel, women personnel. And that has added a great sensitivity dimension and gender balance dimension to the NDRF, which it was lacking. And I'm very proud of them because they are as good, if not better, than the men counterparts.
Absolutely, sir. And lastly, Mr. Pradhan, before we end this conversation, Amphan last year, then Nisarg, and now Tawate, what have these cyclones taught us as far as our rescue and relief operations are concerned for the NDRF?
I think one of the things, Kriti, is that you never underestimate nature. That is the major lesson, because let me give you the example that the last time the cyclone happened in the Arabian Sea once, it came in a recurve and actually curved away towards Oman, and then turned right back and hit the Kandla coast, Kandla port, and wreaked a lot of havoc in the Kandla port. So, with nature, you don't trifle. That is the lesson of humility. So, while respecting the force of nature, we want to not only make people aware that they should not take any risk, but also, while we respect nature, there is another dimension that we are also responsible for this climate change. As human beings, we are responsible for this climate change. So it is high time that the humanity gets together and actually looks at things like climate change and why is the atmosphere heating up, why is the sea surface heating up, why are forests burning. I think it is high time for all of us to look at these bigger issues, because what is the kind of world that we are going to bequeath our children and the next generation? That is something that is very serious, and if there is one big lesson, macro lesson that has come to us and me individually as DGNDR, this is the lesson that we should not spoil the world further. The nature is probably getting back at us for whatever we have done to it, and it is high time to pay back and restore normalcy to nature and climate.
Absolutely, sir. That's a very important point that you're making, and all the very best for all your operations.
Thank you. Thank you.
And thank you so much for talking to Rajya Sabha Television, sir.